Welcome to Yung Tuition. I am Yung. Let's continue discussing general knowledge about climate research over the past century. I'm delighted to see so many comments on my previous talk on atmospheric pressure. In particular, one viewer, Uwe Sindner, made an important distinction between local and global air pressures near the surface. I'd like to invite you to read his comments. Today, I will share with you my latest finding on how to explain quantitatively atmospheric pressure near the surface and atmospheric height at the same time, with a new but very simple idea. Let's go and have fun. It's often argued that the air pressure near the surface can be calculated by adding the weight of all air molecules in the vertical column with a cross section 1 square meter. It sounds plausible, as after all, each air molecule does have its weight due to gravity, first formulated by Issac Newton. But the more you contemplate, the more odd it would appear, as at least it happened to me. For liquid and other condensed matters, all molecules are closely packed one by one or shoulder by shoulder. By way of contrast, air molecules are in random movement all the time and hence can hardly have chance to exert a downward force together. So it seems not very convincing that the total weight of spatially separated molecule can be weighed, say, by an electronic balance. Another question. If you look at this diagram for global atmospheric circulation, you will notice that the troposphere is getting thinner from the equator to the two poles. Why? To quantify this phenomena, I googled the related numbers. Here it is. The height of the troposphere varies from the equator to the two poles. At the equator, it is around 11 to 12 miles. Or 18 to 20 kilometers. But at the two poles, it's just under 4 miles high. That's to say, the thickness at the poles is only 1/3 of that at the equator. So this diagram is roughly accurate. These two questions are my concern last night. When I had my coffee this morning, it occurred to me that the two questions can be answered together by using an extrapolation method similar to how Lord Kelvin deduced the absolute temperature scale in 1848 from systematic experiments of gases. Here are the details. First, imagine the surface temperature can be reduced near the absolute zero, zero Kelvin, similar to the Bose-Einstein condensation. Of course, it's conceptually different. All thermal motion would stop and all air molecule would become condensed matter and hence it could be weighed. In this imagined scenario, everyone will be convinced that the surface air pressure is the total weight of air molecules above the surface due to mass conservation. Second, we know the surface temperature at equator and the two poles are about 300 Kelvin and 200 Kelvin respectively. If I assume the dependence of the troposphere height on the surface temperature is linear, and then the thickness of troposphere would be close to zero when the surface temperature becomes absolute zero, as shown in this blue line. Unfortunately, this slope is too small compared with the trend line in green. But by extrapolating the trend line toward lower temperatures, as shown by this dashed green line, we can see the intercept is well above zero Kelvin. What does that mean? Think about this fact. Nearly 8% of air is made by nitrogen, and the liquid nitrogen temperature is 77 Kelvin. I knew this quite well because I often use liquid nitrogen and liquid helium to do magnetic resonance spectroscopic experiments in the 90s. This implies air would almost become liquid around 77 Kelvin. Indeed, the intercept is close to this temperature. What a surprise. So I replace the first straight line by this linear equation, assuming the thickness of troposphere near the equator is 16 kilometers, where h represents the thickness of the troposphere in kilometer and T is the temperature in Kelvin. Notice the slope simply means if the surface temperature increases by 1 Kelvin, the thickness of the troposphere would increase about 70 meters. But can this number be explained by basic law in physics? Before my coffee getting cold, I found the explanation. Notice the linear dependence of height or the thickness of troposphere on temperature in Kelvin implies both sides of the equation may represent energies of different types, because KT is how much energy each degree of freedom in air molecule can have in a thermal equilibrium, where K is Boltzmann constant. Obviously, the constraint for atmospherical height is caused by gravity, Newton's gravity, not Einstein's geometrical curvatures. Therefore, it is reasonable to make the left-hand side of the equation as gravitational potential energy. That's what I did. Then consider one more air with its mass 29 grams in the imagined thin air in the atmosphere at height h. How could air molecule move that high from the surface? Simple. By directly transforming its kinetic energy gained near the surface into gravitational potential energy, or through multiple Rényi processes. According to energy conservation law, we have this equation, mgh equal to f divided by 2 multiplied rt, where r is gas constant. Of course, T here must be larger than the liquid nitrogen temperature, 77 Kelvin, where F is a degree of freedom. In order to compare the empirical formula derived earlier, we solve for the height, H equal to FR divided by 2 multiply the molar mass of air multiply G, and all of them multiply T. It is known a nitrogen gas molecule has 3 translational degree of freedom and 2 rotational degrees of freedom. That's F equal to 5. We obtained the slope, 0.073 kilometer per Kelvin. Comparing the two numbers, 0.071 and 0.073, wow, almost identical. To help you to understand this explanation, you can imagine the molecules of surface were soccer players. Each air molecule can be visualized as a soccer ball, and the player are repeatedly kicking the ball into the sky all the time. These two diagrams were from a recent paper published in 2023 by Abuch and Lee. Here, GFM and the JJA refer to January, February, and March, and June, July, and August, respectively. They show the change in the atmospherical layer thickness between 1940 and 2022. As you can see, the increase in the thickness is about 20 meters. Using my new equation, it means that the increase in the surface temperature is about 20 divided by 73. Just about 0.27 Kelvin, or 0.27 degrees Celsius, far from 1.5 Kelvin. This is another research paper published in 2016 by Lin and the members of Ramaswamy group from NOAA. As you can see, although the upward shift of the tropopause due to global warming was mentioned, no quantitative explanation was provided. I will let you know more case studies from time to time. To summarize briefly, one, the air pressure near the surface of the Earth can be calculated by treating air in its liquid phase in vertical column with a cross section of 1 square meter below 77 Kelvin. Two, the thickness of the troposphere is proportional to the local surface temperature and inversely proportional to gravitational field strength. However, the global mean air pressure near the surface is determined by the total mass of the atmosphere, which implies that thermal motion of air molecules are responsible for the variation of the thickness of the troposphere above liquid nitrogen temperature, 77 Kelvin. But the surface temperature cannot change the air pressure near the surface. In other words, air pressure dictates the surface temperature, not the other way around. Thank you for watching. Thank you for donation. See you next time.